Jazallahu bil khayrati anna a'immatan lana naqalu al-Qur'ana 'azban wa salsala faminhum budurun sab'atun qad tawasatat sama' al-'ula wal 'adli zuhran wa kummala.
Inshallah ta'ala, now I'm going to go into the importance, ahmiyatu 'ilm al-qira'at, the importance of 'ilm al-qira'at and the virtue and the benefit of learning ilm al-qira'at. I want to first start by saying the previous prophets that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent, they were sent to their people. Every prophet that came, they came to address their people. وَلِذَٰلِكَ you find in the Qur'an, Ya qawmi abudullah, my people worship Allah. Whereas Nabiullah Muhammad, he wasn't just sent to the Arabs. He was sent to all mankind. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Qur'an, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا كَافَةً لِلنَّاسِ بَشِيرًا وَنَذِيرًا وَلَكِنْ أَكْثَرَ النَّاسِ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in this verse, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ مُحَمَّدٍ, we have not sent you, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا كَافَةً لِلنَّاسِ بَشِيرًا وَنَذِيرًا. Muhammad, we sent you to all mankind. And we sent you to do two things. To give glad tidings to those who follow you and adhere to your commandments. And to warn those who go against your prohibitions, or go against your commands, sorry, and they go against your instruction. Warn those people from the hellfire. From that we learn the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sent to all mankind. But the people that the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam was with at that time, the overwhelming majority of them were Arabs. And the Arabs, they were different types of people. They had different types of dialects. They spoke differently. فَالْعَرَبُ قَبَائِلَ شَتَّى. The Arabs are different tribes. لِكُلِّ قَبِيلَ. And every single tribe has a lugha. دَرَجَتْ عَلَى النُّطْقِ بِهَا. And every single tribe, they have a particular type or a particular way in which they talk. And it's not very easy for any tribe to change their speech and their pronunciation and their articulation of words. It's hard. For example, Ahlu Najd, that consists of Tamim and Qais and Asad, for example, they do imala. Kanu yumilun. And imala, meaning imalatul alif ila al-ya, or imalatul fathati ila kasra, like Jannah. We have imala in our qira'ah, Hafs and Asim, majriha. That's an imala, right? The people of Tamim and Qais and Asad, they do imala. Where on the other side, Lughatu al-Hijaz, their language is al-Fath. The people of Tamim, yahmiz. And Quraysh, la yahmiz. They don't do hams. This shows you that the way that these people spoke was different. So it wasn't easy for them to be given all one way of reciting the Qur'an. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala catered for that. It's narrated that the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam كان عند أضات بني غفار. The our Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was at a rivulet or a tank of Bani Ghifar. فأتاه جبريل عليه السلام. Jibreel came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Jibreel said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُكَ أَن تَقْرَأُ أُمَّتَكَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is commanding you, Muhammad, to recite unto your people the Qur'an ala harfin, in one dialect. Then the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Jibreel, أَسْأَلُ اللَّهَ مُعَافَاتَهُ وَمَغْفِرَتَهُ. I ask Allah tabarak wa ta'ala I seek Allah's pardoning and forgiveness. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, I seek Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's pardoning and forgiveness. وَإِنَّ أُمَّتِي لَا تُطِيقُ ذَلِكَ. But my people, they are not able to recite the Qur'an in one dialect because they're Arabs, they're many people. They can't all recite in one way. ثُمَّ أَتَاهُ الثَّانِيَةِ Then Jibreel returned the second time. And then he said to the Prophet, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُكَ أَن تَقْرَأُ أُمَّتَكَ الْقُرْآنَ عَلَىٰ حَرْفَيْنَ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is commanding you, Muhammad, to recite on your people the Qur'an in two dialects. فَقَالَ The Prophet then sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, أَسْأَلُ اللَّهَ مُعَافَاتَهُ وَمَغْفِرَتَهُ I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala his pardoning and his forgiveness. وَإِنَّ أُمَّتِي لَا تُطِيقُ ذَلِكُ My ummah is not able to do that. يعني my ummah are large in number. They have different dialects. They have different methods of speaking. The articulation of words is different and vast. They vary in that matter. For them all to be told to recite in two dialects, that's not something my ummah can do. ثُمَّ جَاءَ الثَّالِثَ Jibreel returned on the third occasion. فَقَالَ He said to the Prophet, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُكَ أَن تَقْرَأُ أُمَّتَكَ الْقُرْآنَ عَلَىٰ ثَلَاثَةِ أَحْرُفٍ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is instructing you to recite the Qur'an in three dialects. Then the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, أَسْأَلُ اللَّهَ مُعَافَاتَهُ وَمَغْفِرَتَهُ I seek refuge. I seek Allah tabarak wa ta'ala's pardoning and his forgiveness. But, وَإِنَّ أُمَّتِي لَا تُطِيقُ ذَلِكَ But that said, my ummah is not able to do that. My ummah cannot recite the Qur'an in three dialects. It's still too little. My ummah are large in number. My ummah vary in their speech and their words and what they say. They're different. فَقَالَ ثُمَّ جَاءَ الرَّابِعَةَ And on the fourth occasion, Jibreel returned and he said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُكَ أَن تَقْرَأُ أُمَّتَكَ الْقُرْآنَ عَلَىٰ سَبْعَةِ أَحْرُفٍ On the fourth occasion, Jibreel came down and he said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُكَ أَن تَقْرَأُ أُمَّتَكَ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is commanding you to recite أَن تَقْرَأُ أُمَّتَكَ الْقُرْآنَ عَلَىٰ سَبْعَةِ أَحْرُفٍ To recite on your people. The Qur'an in seven dialects. فَأَيُّمَا حَرْفٍ قَرَأُوا عَلَيْهِ قَدْ أَصَابُوا And whichever of those dialects in which they recite in, they have got it right. They are accurate and they're precise. So this hadith, it shows that the Arabs and their variation in speech and that the Sab'at Ahruf, in which we're going to speak about inshaAllah ta'ala, bi'idhnillahi al-kareem, was a rukhsa. It was to make it easy for the people when it comes to reciting the Qur'an. Whichever of it is easier for you, you can recite it in. And all of them come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There isn't a harf that the sahabas made up or the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made up. It is all from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Is a talaqi wal mushafaha. You always have to remember that. So this shows us the importance of learning the different types of variations in the Qur'an. Because of the fact that you may not be able to recite in one because it's hard for you, but another one might be easy for you. And inshallah ta'ala, we're going to speak about the relationship between the seven ahruf and the seven qira'at, inshallah ta'ala. We'll speak about what they both are. Are they the same? Does the ahruf contain the qira'at? How does it work? We'll explain that, inshallah ta'ala. Don't worry, bi-idhnillahi al-kareem. So I want to mention a statement of Ibn Hazm that really points out the importance of ilm al-qira'at. Because that's what we're talking about here. Ibn Hazm rahimahullah, he said, ثُمَّ طَلَبُ عِلْمُ الْقُرْآنِ Learning the Qur'an and seeking the knowledge of the Qur'an, وَاخْتِلَافِ السَّبْعَةِ And the differences between the seven reciters. فِيهِ وَضَبْطِ قِرَاءَاتِهِمْ And mastering and being precise in their different types of recitations, he said, كُلُّهُ فَرْضٌ عَلَى الْكِفَايَةِ All of that is a communal obligation. It's not an individual obligation, it's a communal obligation. Meaning, if a group of people learn the 7 qira'at or they learn the 10 qira'at and it's preserved, then inshallah ta'ala, the rest of the ummah are not sinning and they are not in the fault or any error. But if the whole entire ummah abandon the qira'at, then we are all sinners. But as long as there's a group of people standing up to study it, the burden is lifted from the rest. So it's fardun ala al-kifaya. Wa fadlun azeemun liman talabahu, he said. And it's a great reward for whoever goes out to seek the knowledge of qira'at. In kana fi baladihi. If your land, you're in, you reside in, there are little people who've actually studied it. Or even if there are a lot of people, it doesn't matter. If you are learning ilmul qira'at and you're learning the Qur'an, Ibn Hazm rahimahullah said it's a lot of reward. And he mentions the reward comes from the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, خَيْرُكُمْ مَنْ تَعَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنَ وَعَلَّمَهُ. The best of you is the one who learns the Qur'an and he teaches the Qur'an. And Ibn Hazm, he says, فَكَفَى بِذَلِكَ فَضْلًا. This is enough to show you the virtue of learning ilm al-qira'at and the importance of learning ilm al-qira'at. That you are going to be from the best of people. خَيْرُكُمْ, the best of you, is the one who learns the Qur'an and teaches it. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah also spoke about this issue. The importance of ilm al-qira'at and how it's necessary to learn ilm al-qira'at. And he showed, rahimahullah, a principle that's stated by the scholars. أَنَّ الْعِبَادَاتِ أَلَّتِي وَرَدَتْ عَلَى أَكْثَرِ مِنْ سِيغَةِ فَالسُنَّةُ أن يأتي بهذه تارة والأخرى تارة. Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah, he mentions a principle which is, if an ibadat comes in different forms, a particular ibadah has been transmitted to us from the Prophet, but it has come in different forms. He says that the sunnah is that you come with this sometimes and you come with this sometimes. You alternate between it. And whenever you see Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah bring this qa'idah, he generally uses three things: the tashahudat, the istiftahat, and the qira'at. These three, Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah always makes the example for it. The istiftahat means when the Prophet ﷺ used to start the prayer, there were different types of du'as in which the Prophet ﷺ would make. It is best to learn all of them so you can vary between them. Sometimes start with this one, sometimes start with this one. The same is with the tashahudat. The tashahudat that has come from the Prophet are different. There are many different wordings. To learn all of them in order for you to always have khushu' in your prayer. The same applies with the qira'at. The Prophet ﷺ has recited the Qur'an in many different ways. Okay? Learning them and studying them in order to change your recitation in the salah. Sometimes read with qira'at Hafs and Asim, and sometimes read with Shu'bat and Asim, and sometimes read, recite with other recitations. And it alternate between that. And the ibadat التي وردت على أكثر من سيغة فالسنة أن يأتي بهذه تارة والأخرى تارة. ومما يدل على أهمية علم القراءات. From the things that also indicate the importance of علم القراءات, and that it's a great, virtuous, important science, is أنه لا يستغني عنه. A person who's in the sciences of tafsir and fiqh and hadith and nahu and lugha, he cannot be without ilm al-qira'at. You're a mufassir, you have to know ilm al-qira'at. You're a faqih, a jurist, you need ilm al-qira'at. You're a muhaddith, a scholar of hadith, you need ilm al-qira'at. You're a nahwi, a grammarian, you need ilm al-qira'at. Why? لتعلقه بهذه العلوم جميعا. علم القراءات is connected to all of these sciences, intermingled with it. Rather, it's connected to just about every single science within Islam. علم القراءات comes into it. Why would it not? It's the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, inshallah ta'ala, I'm going to, inshallah, prove, give you examples so you can understand the relationship the Quran has and how it impacts and how important it also is for the individual who's going to do tafsir of the Quran. And I'm also going to mention how important it is for the person who wants to do fiqh rulings, that he must know qira'at. I'm also going to mention how ilmul qira'at is necessary for the person who wants to study Arabic grammar, and how it impacts the Arabic language. And last but not least, how ilmul qira'at has an impact on aqeedah and issues related to aqeedah. So it's a science that's very important. Let me give you some examples for you to see how it's all interconnected. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said in the Qur'an, وَلَوْ فَتَحْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ بَابًا مِّنَ السَّمَاءِ فَظَلُّوا فِيهِ يَعْرُجُونَ لَقَالُوا إِنَّمَا سُكِّرَتْ أَبْصَارُنَا بَلْ نَحْنُ قَوْمُ مَسْحُورُونَ. We have a recitation that I recited, which is سُكِّرَتْ أَبْصَارُنَا, which is the qira'ah of the majority of the reciters. But there's some reciters like Ibn Kathir who recites it بِتَخْفِيفِ الْكَافِ. He doesn't say إِنَّمَا سُكِّرَتْ أَبْصَارُنَا. Rather, what he says is إِنَّمَا سُكِّرَتْ أَبْصَارُنَا بِتَخْفِيفِ. He doesn't make it hard. And this actually impacts the meaning of that word. The first meaning, it will be according to the majority of the scholars, the overwhelming majority of scholars who recited it with it بتشديد, is the word سُكِّرَتْ means سُدَّتْ أَبَصَارُنَا, our eyes have been blocked. Whereas if you read it بتخفيف, the قراءه of Ibn Kathir, it becomes سُحِّرَتْ أَبَصَارُنَا, a spell has been cast over our eyes. The verses complement one another in meaning. They don't contradict one another. But you get two magnificent meaning from two different recitations. Let me give you another example. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, وَمَا هُوَ عَلَى الْغَيْبِ بِضَنِينَ وَمَا هُوَ عَلَى الْغَيْبِ بِضَنِينَ. The word بِضَنِينَ, there's two recitations. There's the recitation of Ibn Kathir and Abu Amr and Al-Kisai, who recited it بِالضَى. Ta-za-ain. Recited it as bidhanin. According to that recitation, the meaning means وَمَا هُوَ عَلَى الْغَيْبِ بِضَنِينَ means أي متهم. Muhammad is not one that is suspected. He's not one that's suspected. That's if we read it بِالضَى according to the qira'ah of Ibn Kathir, Abu Amr and Al-Kisai. But if you read it according to the qira'ah of the Al-Baqul, بِالضَّات, it becomes the meaning ببخيل وما هو على الغيب بضنين means أي ببخيل. Muhammad is not one who is stingy with this information and this knowledge that he has. He's not one that is stingy. Muhammad will definitely share it. So what we've just taken is two examples of how the qira'at affected the tafsir and how the mufassir is in need of qira'at. Now I'm going to give you an example of how the faqih, the person who is studying fiqh, who's into fiqh, how ilm al-qira'at also impacts them. I'm just going to give one example, inshallah ta'ala. Qawluhu ta'ala in Surah Al-Ma'idah, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu idha qumtum ila salati faghsilu wujuhakum wa aydiyakum ila al-marafiqi wamsahu bi ru'usikum wa arjulakum and wa arjulikum. We have two recitations. Wa arjulakum bin nasbi wa arjulakum, which is the qira'ah of Nafi' wa ibn Amir wa al-Kisai wa Hafs wa Ya'qub. Wa qara'a al-Baqun, and the overwhelming majority of the qura', I mean the large amount of the qura' or the other qura', they recited it as bil-jarri wa arjulikum. Does those two affect the meaning? Yes, they do. According to the nasb, if you say wa arjulakum, it means wash the leg. It's then atf on faghsilu wujuhakum wa aydiyakum. That's what it's connected to. So you're going to say washing the legs. That is if you say wa arjulakum, which is what we recite Hafs and Asim. If you recite it as wa arjulikum, it's connected with what? Wamsahu biru'usikum. It's talking about wiping the legs. And when is it that you wipe your legs? Al-mashu al-khufayn. You wipe over your khufayn, not your leg, the khufayn. or the jawrab. So on those two qira'ah, we have two different rulings taken from it. The qira'ah of an-nasb, which is the qira'ah of Nafi' wa ibn Amir wa al-Kisai wa Hafs wa Ya'qub, gives us that washing the leg has to be done for the leg. And the other qira'ah, the other qura' who recited it bil-jarri, we take from it wiping over the jawrab, amma the khufayn. Now inshallah ta'ala, I want to show the relationship for the Arabic language and al-qira'at, how important it is for the scholar of the Arabic language and who is studying the Arabic language, who is studying grammar, how important ilm al-qira'at is for that person. As the scholars have stated and mentioned, the scholar of the Arabic language who studied the Arabic language, who's into the Arabic language, one thing he doesn't have is that how the Arabs pronounce things. The issue of pronunciation has not been transmitted to the person in the Arabic language. And we don't know how the Arabs said this word with their mouth. We know the kasra, the dhamma, the fatha, we know that. But what we don't know is the idgham, the idhar, the ikhfa. We don't know all of that. That is preserved through the Qur'an. Like mas'alatu al-ishmam, for example. The ulama al-nahw, they speak about it, but they took it from the qira'at. They borrowed it from the qira'at. ولذلك ابن مالك, when he's saying, وَاكْسِرْ أَوِشْ مِنْ فَاءَ ثُلَاثِيٍ أُعِلْ عَيْنًا وَضَمٌ جَاكَ بُوعَ فَحْتُمِلْ. Where did he get that from, the issue of ishmam? He got it from the qira'at, because that's not present. علم النحو or صرف does not deal with how something is pronounced, okay, in the way that the word is said on the lips. It's not. So مسألة الإشمام, إضغام, إضحار, and إخفاء, the نوحات, they take it from the علم القراءات. فلذلك لقى الإمام الشاطبي, he said وقيل وغيظ ثم جاء يشمها لدى كسرها ضم الرجال لتكملا وحيل بإشمام وسيق كما رسى وسيئة وسيئة كان راويه أنبلا. يعني مسألة الإشمام is owned by the قراءات and it's borrowed from them, put into grammar. Another example I want to give that shows the relationship between Nahu and Qira'at. The mas'ala that the grammarians speak about a lot, which is it permissible atfu ala jawazul atfi ala al-dhamir al-majrur duna i'adat al-jari. For example, marattu bika anta wa zaydin. Am I allowed to say that? Without saying wa bi zaydin. I don't bring back the harf jar. I say marattu bika anta wa zaydin. Marattu bika wa zaydin. Ha. Is that right? Is that fair? The Basriyin, they said, no, it's not right. You can only say that inda darura, when there's a necessity for it. You can't say other than that. The Kufiyin came back and they said, you can say it. What's the problem? Marartu bika wa zaydin, you can say it without having to say wa bi zaydin. And our evidence for that is the qira'ah of Hamza. You know, Habib al-Zayyat. Shatibi says, wa kufiyuhum tasa'aluna mukhaffafan wa hamzatu wal arhama bil khafti jammala. يعني وحمزة والأرحام بالخفض جملة. حمزة recited the ayah يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام. حمزة بن حبيب الزيات recited it like that. And it's a qira'ah which is متواترة. So it's allowed. It's actually a recitation of the Quran. So the Basriyun was silenced based on a recitation, a qira'ah. ولذلك ابن مالك rejected the argument of the Basriyin and he said, وَعَوْدُ خَافِضٍ لَدَى عَطْفٍ عَلَى ضَمِيرِ خَفْضٍ لَازِمًا قَدْ جُعِلَ وَلَيْسَ عِنْدِي لَازِمًا إِذْ قَدْ أَتَى فِي النَّظْمِ وَالنَّثْرِ الصَّحِيحِ مُثْبَتًا. He didn't accept that from them because a qira'ah sab'iyyah has come regarding this issue. It distinguished what is right from what is wrong. Clarified everything for us. That really shows you al-alaqa bayna al-qira'at wa lughat al-arabiyya. The relationship between qira'at and the Arabic language. What about the relationship between qira'at and aqidah? And does it have an effect on aqidah? Yes, it does. It does. قوله تعالى, the ayah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, بَلْ عَجِبْتَ وَيَسْخَرُونَ. Qira'at Hamza and Kisa'i is بَلْ عَجِبْتُ instead of بَلْ عَجِبْتَ. So what's the difference? If it's بَلْ عَجِبْتَ, which is the Qira'at al-Baqoon, بَلْ عَجِبْتَ. If you read it like that, بَلْ عَجِبْتَ وَيَسْخَرُونَ, then of course the khitab is the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is talking to the Prophet here. But if you recite it in the recitation of Hamza and Kisa'i, and you read it as بَلْ عَجِبْتُ, then this becomes ayah. This ayah becomes min ayati sifat. It becomes ayat sifat. What does that mean? It means that you're now affirming for Allah sifatul ajab. Sifatul ajab is a characteristic that we affirm for Allah. We already do that based on the hadiths that have come regarding it. But you've now got an ayah for it as well. You've got an ayah to affirm ajab for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, ilm al-qira'at is a very, very important science, as you can see. It's connected to all of those sciences and many more that I have chosen to leave out. So in this inshallah ta'ala episode, you learned the importance of ilm al-qira'at and how important it is for each and every one of us to study it, to learn it.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. How can you do a 2-second action right now that will give you a share of the reward of everything we're doing on this YouTube channel? Simple. Like this video and click subscribe. Why? It will allow YouTube to recommend our videos to other users. And imagine the huge amount of reward that could be waiting for you on the Day of Judgment if you did that with a sincere intention of spreading the Deen of Allah. You'll be rewarded for every single person who benefits from one of our videos as a result of your like or subscribe. That's an easy 2-second action that you definitely don't want to miss out on. Do it now, click like and subscribe, and don't forget to make that intention.